Welcome, heroes. Welcome once more to the lair of OmnusI. I, of course, am OmnusI, and you are most welcome here. This is a little bit different from the previous levels of the lair of OmnusI, however. This is a condensed episode, reviewing the details of Episode 1, the experience of the game, in a new series for those people who don't enjoy long videos where I frankly explain everything so that those who don't grasp my initial statements have a chance to catch up, especially for those who don't have a great deal of experience in role-playing. So, whereas before, I would be doing a wall of talking and trying to explain everything that I mean, in this one, it's short, straight to the point, just like a critical hit. In the experience of the game, I went at great lengths to attempt to explain that role-playing games themselves are not some mysterious, otherworldly, geek culture experience and phenomenon. There's a commonality in role-playing that exists through many entertainment endeavors that you might have experienced. Board games, where you take on a role within the game, even though you don't often attribute many of your decisions to those particular roles, keeping the strategy of trying to win at all costs, you could escape into a role of a real estate tycoon in Monopoly, for instance, or a general in a game of Risk. So, in those regards, there are small elements of role play and imagining that you can do in most games. However, true role playing games generally are an exercise in which one or more people make decisions and play a game that emulates things that they don't normally do in real life. So, therefore, they take on a role to slip away into a level of entertainment. And many of these experiences and games, again, lie outside of what a person normally would do. In Monopoly, most people don't have billions of dollars to spend on real estate and development. So therefore, we slip away in a game where we try to dominate others and run them out of business. In a more traditional role-playing game, each of the participants takes on a role within the game to attempt to tell a narrative story or to attempt to pit themselves up against a challenge in a more tactical environment. Those are the two general forms of role-playing games, and they are not mutually exclusive. Many can contain elements of both styles of play. What most people consider when they think of a role-playing game, the most stereotypical being based on classical games like Dungeons & Dragons, Tunnels & Trolls, all the way up through games like Shadowrun, Star Wars role-playing games, and plenty of others, generally involves a relatively set role scenario. Most of the people participating are players. They take on the role of one or more characters, and they decide the actions that their characters take, responding to stimuli and events that happen in the world around them. This is all described, narrated, and put into motion by a game master, somebody who is in charge of the game, plays all the characters that aren't specifically controlled by the player characters, and makes sure that the rules are followed throughout the game. Primarily, this pattern follows most role-playing games, although some of them do tinker with the formula a bit, and some groups have different arrangements. For example, allowing individual people to take over the position of Game Master to give everybody a chance to play. Now, those two separate roles are pretty distinct. The Game Master having a lot of responsibility, generally, to run the world in a logical and coherent manner so that the players can play their characters as they need to. However, there is give and take on both sides. The players do have to participate, at the very least, thinking tactically for their characters. As far as the rules, they can be incredibly varied. Some people prefer dense, articulated rules with given subsets of rules for almost any circumstance you can imagine. Some of them play very fast and loose, don't have a great deal of structured, rigid rules, and therefore it's very easy for the game master to make changes on the fly or to whip in extra insanity when things get a little too dull. An exhaustive list would take me longer than the actual episode took, so you'll just have to look out for yourself for the types of games that are available. However, most of them do follow the example that I set as far as structure with the roles of the different players versus the game master. As varied as those rules are, the props that are involved in playing the games are also varied. The individual characters are usually going to have all of the stats and figures that they need delineated on a character sheet, which they keep on them as they are playing, so that they can refer to the sheet, so that they can understand the limits, rules, abilities, attributes, and skills that their characters can bring forth into the game. Most of the rulings will be based upon what those characters can do, as opposed to the difficulties of the world around them. Oftentimes, in role-playing games, dice or some other random element is used to determine success or failure at any venture in which there's an element of risk that both includes the opportunities for success and failure. Generally, in a logical role-playing game, it's not a 50-50. If a person has stacked the deck that they have a better chance of succeeding, say with the proper gear or circumstances, then the odds should favor that venture be successful. On the other hand, a very difficult one will have a slighter chance of success. So, that possibility of success versus failure is one of the enticing things about role-playing games. Those triumphs that become so memorable become a triumph of the player, as well as that of the character. And working together with many instances of these opportunities for failures and successes generates a continuous story element. Now, sometimes the props that a person uses will be something like dice, which you can collect, and in the original episode I did talk in length about those. You can also use things like cards. Various games, based on the rules, will have these different things that you can use. In addition, if you're going to run a tactical game, it might be a good idea to have some physical representation of the world that the players will be crawling around through. That would include things like a map or a layout for the players, as well as tokens to represent the individual characters. With those in hand, the players can then make their tactical decisions about what their characters will do or can do in their environment. You can be very elaborate in these if you'd like, or you can go with simplicity. Both work. It all depends on your group and your means. After this point, I went on a rather lengthy segment with player, my useful player prop, who demonstrated a bit of the interplay between the game master and the player as we took turns, demonstrating and illuminating the three primary aspects of most role-playing games. The first, exploration, puts the players in a position that their character's actions can illuminate the world around them. They can look for what is hidden. They can choose the avenue the characters choose to go in. In a dungeon setting, this may mean picking a particular door or corridor to explore, or searching for information about their environs. In a more narrative-driven experience, it may lead the players to making decisions on how their characters are going to go forth, what to communicate with, what to purchase, what to look into or investigate. That may advance the storyline and advance the adventure. Now, the exploration phase is but one. The second is the tactical phase, or combat. Combat is oftentimes a very large part in a role-playing game in any particular book. Most of that book is going to be involving either rules for combat or explaining different instances that can affect combat, like spells that can affect combat, or different tactics, or the effects of combat wounds and injury and illness and dying and things. So, with such a large part involved in a game, and also, again, remembering that role-playing games allow us to do what we ourselves would not do, combat is something that is fairly easy to understand why it is such a draw, a release Your characters are probably going to have several stats based on combat, and it's fun to be able to use those from time to time on foes that are richly deserving of such. So, in terms of the combat aspect, the players are generally allowed to use most of their character sheet as far as the gear they have, the powers they have developed, the advantages that they have gained from experience from repeated play. This can be, in some games, the entirety of the game. If one whole adventure is one dungeon crawl, for instance, there may not be much other than exploring to get to the next combat scenario. The final avenue that's primarily common to role-playing games is the role-playing element, wherein you act out in the guise of your character. This is minimized in some groups, as some players don't feel comfortable playing in the shoes of their character, but it is one of those elements that is most commonly used to judge if a game is actually a role-playing game or not. The Game Master will typically talk as some of his NPCs, although, again, the amount this can happen is maybe diminished if the Game Master prefers just narrating what the person says rather than how they say it. However, role-playing is one of those avenues by which a person can truly grasp the spotlight and execute the most minute detail onto how their character is going to manipulate the world around them. That doesn't necessarily mean that that particular manipulation has to be savvy. A person playing a wild barbarian, for example, may enjoy the license to get creative with, say, insults at the opening of a bar brawl, just as an example. However, it is that element of a game that some people thrive and shine at, the opportunity for stepping into the literal shoes of their character, looking out through their eyes and imagining the fellows around them as being their characters and the Game Master as being the player or the character in front of them, is, for some people, an incredible draw for being involved in one of these role-playing games. I myself have had experiences acting, and I can tell you that, yes, role-playing games have a lot of the same feeling for those who enjoy being in a role and performing in front of others. So, the only other thing that I really covered for those who were new to this type of entertainment venue was if that you found this to be interesting or intriguing, there were a number of avenues that I encouraged you to go along, such as finding internet groups on sites like Facebook, or going to your favorite local gaming store and seeing if anybody has a game open. I've even seen groups take out personal ads about trying to find a group to roleplay with. So, whatever you can do, if the group is in your basement, or if you are FaceTiming or Skyping with other people, there's many avenues for role-playing. And since this was generally targeted towards beginners, again, I would exhort you, if this sounds fun, check it out. There's a number of live feeds on YouTube that you can watch people playing, as well as those groups on Facebook that you can participate in. So, this is but my first critical hit. I am OmnusI, and I hope that you find this to be very illuminating. Thank you.